Hello everyone, and welcome to this webinar brought to you by the Y&S Nazarian Center for Israel Studies at UCLA. I'm Dov Waxman, the director of the Nazarian Center and the Rosalind and Arthur Gilbert Foundation Chair of Israel Studies at UCLA. After 12 consecutive years in power and four national elections in just 2 years, Benjamin Netanyahu, Israel's longest serving prime minister, was finally forced out of office in June. Although he remains the leader of the Likud party, the largest party in Israel's parliament, and he could still make a political comeback, it's worth considering the legacy of this controversial leader who is widely loved and loathed by Israelis. To do this, we have a distinguished speaker, Dr. Neil Lockery, who is Professor of Middle Eastern and Mediterranean Studies at University College London. He's the author of The Resistible Rise of Benjamin Netanyahu, which was published by Bloomsbury in 2016, as well as numerous other books about Israel and the Arab-Israeli conflict, including The Israeli Labour Party in the Shadow of the Likud, Loaded Dice, The Foreign Office in Israel, The View from the Fence, Why Blame Israel, and The Difficult Road to Peace. During Dr. Lockery's presentation, I encourage you to send in your questions, which I will put to him during the Q&A. So without further ado, let me welcome Dr. Neil Lockery. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you very much for the invitation. Good afternoon, everybody. Okay. Well, thank you for, like I said before, thank you for the invitation. It's a great honor to be able to speak on the topic tonight. And I'm going to talk about trying to contextualize Benjamin Netanyahu's legacy. And in doing that, I want to really put him within the context of other Israeli leaders. And I want to look at also something about Israel's story. I would like to also contextualize his leadership within, I think, three key foreign policy areas: US-Israeli relations, Israeli-Russian relations, and Israeli-European relations, with a sort of focus on the UK and Brexit and the implications of that to his legacy. I think just before I start, it's very important when you're looking at someone's legacy. And again, you know, this is very early days. As Dove said, that we don't know if Netanyahu is going to make a political comeback to come back to the prime ministership in Israel. We have a relatively strange situation at the present, where we have a prime minister who commands only 7 seats in the Knesset, is not the largest party. And Mr. Netanyahu commands the largest party with 30 seats. And that's something I want to cover later when we discuss coalition formation in Israel, and specifically the relationship between the two blocs in Israel, which has always been important, but it has taken on in recent years even greater importance. So let me start. 21 years ago, yes, 21 years ago, I published a book. It was one of the first books on the Netanyahu first premiership. It was called The Difficult Road to Peace: Netanyahu, Israel, and the Middle East Peace Process. Seems like a long, long time ago. And in that book, I tried to look at the legacy of Netanyahu, who at the time looked like he was going to be a very short-term Israeli prime minister. His first period in office ran to under 3 years. It coincided with some very complicated issues, particularly the slowing down and eventual collapse of the Oslo peace process. It also coincided with the complicating factor of the direct elections for prime minister in Israel, which, although it intended to strengthen the position of the prime minister, actually led to the opposite situation, due largely to the fragmentation of the Knesset and the fact that as prime minister, Mr. Netanyahu was forced to put together a coalition of 8 or 9 political parties or factions, all of who had very different views on key issues. And the management of the coalition was, I think, the major problematical issue for Mr. Netanyahu during his first period in office, and was actually the issue which I think largely compounded to his defeat in the 1999 Israeli elections. The other characteristic that I got from the first Netanyahu administration, which I think is still very relevant to current politics in Israel, which was the seemingly two masters of Netanyahu having to appeal to his political base in Israel versus pressure from the American administration. As you know, during the first Netanyahu administration, the American president was President Clinton, who was intent on pushing through the Oslo process. And that, I think, was a very difficult situation for any prime minister to manage when large parts of his governing coalition were at best lukewarm, or more likely against furthering the Oslo process. And the Americans were extremely keen to resolve the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, certainly through the Oslo process. So difficulties in his first administration. And I, before I gave the talk, I went back and looked at the book. It's, you know, it's an old book, but it was still very interesting to see some of the difficulties that Netanyahu faced between 1996 and 1999. I then published a biography, which came out in 2016, A Resistible Rise of Benjamin Netanyahu. And I should say something about the title here. The title wasn't my idea of a title. The editor kind of forced it upon me. My title for the book was actually The Rise and Fall of Benjamin Netanyahu. Because when I was writing the book, it appeared odds on that Mr. Netanyahu would lose an Israeli election, which was scheduled for 17th of March, 2015. All the commentators in Israel, all the pundits, all the opinion polls were indicating that this was the end of the line for Benjamin Netanyahu. And in the last couple of days of campaigning, he walked back a couple of policies, most notably his acceptance of a Palestinian state. And on election day, in a major surprise to the pollsters, to Israeli television, and to the outside world, who was watching with some glee what they believed to be the decline of Benjamin Netanyahu, he pulled the rabbit out of the hat and managed to win an election that people thought he was sure to lose. So my notion of doing the rise and fall was somewhat taken aback by that. But in the book, I talk about the defining moments in his life and his career, both his personal and political struggles. And I think it's really important to look at the conflicts that he's had to deal with. In terms of his personal life, I'm a kind of biographer who doesn't like to look too much about that, particularly in terms of contemporary leaders. I think sometimes that's overused by people. But certainly in terms of his political conflicts, it was a fascinating journey for me to go back and trace his political rise. And more importantly, I think, to really look at his reinvention as a leader. In 1999, when he lost the election to Ehud Barak, by a landslide in Israeli standards, his career in Israeli politics looked over. You know, in American politics, if you lose a national election, you're pretty much done and dusted. Thank you very much. Good night. But Israel is not America. And it was really interesting tracing his comeback first as Minister of Finance, and then watching how Israeli society fell much more in line, or key parts of Israeli society fell much more in line with his policies in the first decade of the 21st century, with perhaps the only surprise being actually that it took him so long to return to the premiership. And he didn't return to the premiership, as many of you will know, until 2009. And that was largely following the resignation of Ehud Olmert on corruption charges and the 2009 election, in which Netanyahu actually in the Likud did not emerge as the largest party, but he was chosen by President Shimon Peres as being the person most able to form a winning coalition in the Knesset, you know, 61 seats or more, largely because prior to the election, he'd been able to strike a number of deals with the ultra-Orthodox and Orthodox religious parties, which gave him a winning majority in the Knesset. And in doing this book, I was also quite fascinated by the political culture. And when you look at the impact of a leader, I think you can look at the impact of a leader on specific policies. And there are three policies, like I say, I want to look at: the Arab-Israeli conflict and foreign policy, secular religious issues, and also socioeconomic issues. And those three issues are the issues that dominate Israeli politics. And anybody who follows Israeli politics will know the complications of each of those. But Netanyahu wasn't only influential in terms of policy, he was also influential in terms of political culture in Israel. And I think the most significant change, as many people talk about, was the Americanization of American politics. Today, it all appears very matter of the fact, Israeli style of politics mirroring an American style. But when Netanyahu's career really started in the 1990s, Israeli politics was extremely different. It really was, you know, it was dominated by elders. Most of them couldn't put together a soundbite, either in Hebrew or English, for any kind of media outlet. Indeed, such a thing was frowned upon as being above many Israeli political leaders. And there was very much a lack of democratization within the two major parties. The Labour Party didn't have its first election for leadership until 1974. Prior to that, leaders were elected in what we call smoke-filled rooms. After 74, still a very narrow group of party workers selected the leader. And within the Likud, there was kind of a what we have in Britain in the Conservative Party, and a leader would emerge. So when Menachem Begin stood down in 1983 after the Lebanon War and the death of his wife, he was succeeded by a kind of an agreement by Yitzhak Shamir, who became prime minister and continued to be leader of the Likud until 1992, or early 1993, when he was succeeded by Benjamin Netanyahu. And so the advent of primary elections in Israel for both the Likud and Labour, and now for almost every political party within Israel, I think was a sizable change, as was the communication of Israeli politicians. Netanyahu was really the first to go out and be able to communicate with the international media effectively. Probably within the ranks of Labour, only Abba Iban, who was fluent in seven or eight languages, was able to do that in the late 1960s, early 1970s. But in terms of this very sort of soundbite culture that dominated the media, particularly with the advent of 24-hour news, et cetera, around the end of the 1980s, start of the 1990s, this was he was very much a man of his times and a man which Israel in many ways needed to be able to put out there, certainly internationally. And I'm sure many of you who are watching tonight will, their first experience of Netanyahu would have been seeing him on CNN, seeing the interviews during the Persian Gulf War of 1991, watching him don the gas mask during an attack of Iraqi Scud missiles onto Tel Aviv. And those kind of images and the kind of change in sort of political culture in Israel, I think, are very important, a very important part, I think, of his legacy. Maybe not call it Americanization, maybe call it a modernization of Israeli politics. So I wanted to place Netanyahu in context of other Israeli leaders. And the most obvious ones to choose are two people. First, David Ben-Gurion. Why Ben-Gurion? Well, Ben-Gurion, until Netanyahu overtook him, was the longest serving Israeli prime minister, one of the most influential in the short history of Israel. We've all seen the pictures of him declaring the state of Israel on the 14th of May, 1948. We know the story of his life. We know the fact that he was the leader in the pre-state Jewish institutions in the British Mandate in Palestine. And he continued to rule Israel on and off, really, until the 1960s. However, like many great politicians, Ben-Gurion's career really ended in failure. And many people forget that when we talk about his contribution towards Israel. The Lavon affair of 1954-1955 was an issue which simply did not go away, and which Ben-Gurion refused to let die. For those of you who don't know what the Lavon affair is, please look it up. It's one of the most significant events in Israeli politics. And it says a lot about civil-military relations in Israel and a lot of the problems between civil-military relations that characterized this period in Israeli history. Ben-Gurion refused to accept the findings of a state commission, tried to overturn it. This went round and round in circles until eventually Ben-Gurion left Mapai, the party that he had founded, formed his own party, Rafi, and lost the 1965 Knesset elections. He tried to make a comeback prior to the Six-Day War in June 1967. He was a kind of backseat driver behind the decision to form a national unity government prior to the war. He hoped that he would come back as prime minister, but that didn't emerge, and Levi Eshkahol remained as prime minister. So when we look at comparisons, people often talk about the failings of Netanyahu, but when we put them into other contexts, we can see that no other Israeli leader, I don't think, not even the most notable perhaps in David Ben-Gurion, actually had a very easy ride. And in terms of his career, certainly internally within Israel, the last 10 years of Ben-Gurion's career really took away a lot of the gloss of the achievements that he had managed to put together prior to that. So many failings on that account. And when you compare this to Netanyahu, Netanyahu has had many failings, as we will talk about later, but certainly arguably nothing as big as the last 10 years of Ben-Gurion's career. And that brings me to the second leader. And clearly the other man to compare, or to contextualize, sorry, Netanyahu to, I think, was Menachem Begin. Menachem Begin was the leader of Gahal, the leader of Likud. This is a man who stayed in opposition for 29 years. Wow, 29 years in opposition, from 1948 up until 1977, when the Likud came to power. This was a man who became prime minister in 77, like I said, and remained prime minister until 1983, when he retired. A very controversial figure, certainly in Europe, a man who achieved the great prize of making peace with Egypt, the Camp David Accords, extremely important. The first major Arab-Israeli peace accord and he signed it with President Sadat, witnessed by President Jimmy Carter. And that peace has remained intact pretty much ever since. So an enormous achievement there. But like Ben-Gurion, Begin had failings as well. And I think it's widely perceived within Israel and internationally that the 1982 Lebanon War was ill-advised and was certainly from a political and a geostrategic point of view, not a particularly successful war for Israel. And certainly Begin, the character, took the war and the casualties very much to heart. And this was clearly one of the reasons for his resignation in 1983. So I think these two leaders, David Ben-Gurion and Menachem Begin, these are the two leaders that are often by historians pushed forward as being these great powerhouses of Israeli leadership. And the point I want to make was that when we look at them carefully, we also need to look at some of their failings as well. And sometimes when you're dealing with a contemporary leader, there is a kind of overemphasis on dealing with their failings and largely ignoring the pluses. While when you go back further back in history, that we tend to gloss over some of the failings of previous leaders and emphasize some of their success stories. And this is a kind of natural thing to do, but it's one that we need to be wary of as you make an initial assessment on a leader who, even though he's no longer prime minister, is still certainly active in politics. For me, I think one of the key turning points for Mr. Netanyahu's career was the assassination of Yitzhak Rabin, 4th of November, 1995. And I remember this very well, actually being there. I remember thinking that I cannot see a way how, given everything that happened in the days immediately following Mr. Rabin's death, that Benjamin Netanyahu, who at the time was a leader of the opposition Likud party, could survive. Rightly or wrongly, the amount of attacks against him in the press, saying that he was complicit in the killing of Rabin. These are issues that you can debate hotly, and I think need to be looked at. You know, I've been looked at historically very carefully. What I would say at the time in Israel, there was an enormous polarization of politics caused by Oslo. And the language, I think, on both sides of the political divide on Israel wasn't particularly pleasant. If any of you have ever been to the Knesset, you would have been quite shocked if you'd been there in 1995, hearing some of the swearing and the shouting and the obscenities that were going on. I mean, it was really a very polarized debate in Israel. And I think it says something about the survival instinct of Netanyahu that he was able to come back from this and not only come back from the people targeting as being partly to blame for creating the culture surrounding the assassination, but within 6 months, he had gone from being seemingly unelectable to beating Shimon Peres in the direct election for prime minister in 1996. And in a direct election, he beat Peres. The margin was relatively narrow, but it was still relatively convincing as well. And in a two-man race, it was really a major surprise that he was able to reinvent himself. And for me, although this is not for tonight, really, but I think this is another important point to make maybe here, that I think as Netanyahu arrives in power in 1996, one thing that I noticed that I think is quite important is we really see the acceleration in the decline of the Israel Labour Party. And yes, it comes back in 1999 and Ehud Barak wins and was able to serve for 18 months. But largely after that, the Labour Party starts to disappear, not completely, but as a viable major party of government. And I think for that, one of the major reasons has been the party's inability to effectively find a candidate to succeed Rabin as a kind of centrist candidate who was able to reassure center ground voters, which largely determine Israeli elections, about Israel's security. And that's probably a talk for another day, but I think it's an important point to make in terms of looking at Mr. Netanyahu's rise and perhaps looking at reasons why, when he came back for a second time, he was able to remain in power for an extended period. During the first Netanyahu period, as I mentioned at the start of the talk, number of difficult issues to deal with. Oslo Accords, and here the Oslo Accords were really starting to fall to pieces, I think, or prior to him coming to power. There were signs in Israel that Mr. Rabin was growing increasingly concerned about implementing the Accords further. Number of suicide bomb attacks in Israel, making progress very, very difficult. And Netanyahu tried to introduce new strategies and tactics into the peace process. Particularly, a key word was to try and get the PLO to renounce from their charter, parts of their charter that called for the destruction of Israel in return for advancing at the peace process, and to, in effect, try and downplay Palestinian expectations as to the amount of land that they would get, etc. And I think this really reflected very much different visions, certainly a different vision between Shimon Peres, who is now leader or opening leader of the Labour Party, and Mr. Netanyahu. But clearly, the major shift, I think, in Netanyahu's politics, we saw during the 96 campaign, and we saw it in his years in office up until 1999. And that was really the decline in ideology and its replacement with pragmatism. Now, pragmatism is a huge specter. If you say someone is pragmatic, I mean, they can be strongly pragmatic, moderately pragmatic, mildly pragmatic. But nonetheless, Netanyahu shifted from saying he wanted nothing to do with the Oslo Accords. He described the Oslo Accords in the campaign in 96 as having more holes than a Swiss cheese. And the shift from that to at least trying to move them forward. And I think this was very much done as part of what I mentioned at the start, was trying to move between his two masters. One, his constituency, and specifically his cabinet, who were very reluctant to move forward and actually openly oppose, many of them, the Oslo process. And secondly, the Clinton administration, which certainly following the assassination of Yitzhak Rabin, wanted to see the Oslo Accords fully implemented. And as Clinton struggled more and more domestically, particularly over the scandal of Monica Lewinsky and the fallout of that domestically, he was very much looking for a kind of foreign policy legacy, some kind of achievement that he could point to. So his concentration on pushing the Israeli-Palestinian process forward, I think, became all the greater. And I mean, one thing that I noticed in the researching of the book, and this is maybe interesting for the legacy, is despite all his rhetoric, it should be remembered that Netanyahu met with Arafat on several occasions. He actually developed a relatively warm but distant personal relationship with Arafat. Final status talks never really got underway, but he did sign the Hebron Accords, a hugely complicated and almost unworkable agreement, by the way. He signed that in 1997. And in 1998, he also signed with the PLO, the Y Memorandum. Scholars like myself use the Y Memorandum to teach our students how not to negotiate any kind of peace agreement. It is perhaps one of the worst. It's not really an agreement, hence its name, a memorandum. It's a change to existing agreements, but the timetabling within the memorandum is almost unworkable, and we use it to teach our students how not to make peace. Stalemate followed, and then we saw what was very much becomes a part of any politician's legacy, a blame game as to who was to blame for the suspension and eventual collapse of the Oslo process. And here, certainly in Europe took a very critical line towards Mr. Netanyahu. Clearly, European leaders, specifically Tony Blair, who was elected in England in May 1997, made it publicly clear that he blamed Netanyahu for the lack of advancement. Let's be polite, the lack of advancement in the peace process. President Chirac of France, likewise, as well. In America, it was much more of a complicated picture. So Netanyahu loses in 1999, and we think all that's over, and we talk about his legacy, a legacy which many of us termed as being crisis management, an administration that had lurched from crisis to crisis, that had really failed to address many of the key issues in Israel. Scholars like myself talked about the difficulties in the government, the fact it had 8 or 9 parties in the coalition, problems of coalition management, and the deep divisions within the parties in the government. Well, Netanyahu was replaced, as you know, I'm sure, by Ariel Sharon. Ariel Sharon was someone who'd never really accepted Netanyahu's leadership of the Likud. Sharon, a strange political background, a man originally from Labour, crossed over, was one of the founders of the Likud in 1993. And Sharon comes to power in the start of 2001, in which he scored an electoral landslide, the biggest electoral victory in Israel's history, over the incumbent Ehud Barak. Number of reasons for that, but specifically the major reason was the outbreak of the second Palestinian Intifada, or what the IDF called ebb and flow, and the resulting casualties from that. Unlike the first Intifada, it was a much bloodier Intifada, attacks in Israel, suicide bomb attacks in Israel. And this brought Sharon to power. And Sharon seemed to move away from the Netanyahu policies and shift very much more and introduce new words into peacemaking, such as disengagement and unilateral withdrawal. And the unilateral withdrawal from Gaza was the major move of his government. Whether or not that was successful or not depends on how you I think view the resulting conflict. And Sharon also was the mainstay behind the creation, or the construction, I should say, of Israel's security fence over 600 kilometers, never fully finished, but at the time it looked like the best way of essentially dividing the Israelis and the Palestinians. And essentially Sharon's view on peacemaking was a divorce. You know, us on one side of the fence, the Palestinians on the other side of the fence. And that had been largely articulated as well, actually, by Ehud Barak from Labour as well. But perhaps one of the most interesting decisions of Ariel Sharon was to appoint Benjamin Netanyahu as Minister of Finance. It was an interesting appointment because Netanyahu was clearly a major rival to Sharon, and Netanyahu had left Israel and had largely been working in America doing consultancy and basically making money. I mean, he'd left office and he'd gone into the private sector to make money. Let me just jump forward, sorry. And for Mr. Netanyahu, it was a difficult decision to come back as Minister of Finance, but what really appealed to him was the fact that he would be able to address some of the key issues of the Israeli economy. At this point, at the start of the 21st century, the Israeli economy was crying out for liberalization, the opening up of the economy, deregulation, and also selling off of some state assets as well. The state sector was bloated and inefficient, and Netanyahu was considered to be the man to address the old socialist style economy in Israel and bring it more into line with a sort of Thatcherite, Reaganite modern economy. Now, there was a problem for Netanyahu in doing this because the majority of the Likud party, which Sharon led and Netanyahu was now still in, they were really believed in redistribution. They were socialist with a small c. Now you're thinking, well, Likud socialist was a small c. Well, in terms of Arab-Israeli conflict, hawkish, but the Likud in terms of economics were essentially redistributionists. Why? Because large parts of their constituency were from the lower income workers and they wanted to look after them. And traditionally, this is what they had done. So what Netanyahu was actually doing would actually in the short term damage many of the people who supported Likud. And so this was a very sort of brave thing in many ways he did, because it certainly did his leadership prospects to return to as leader of Likud very little good in the short term. And while people talk about a legacy and people talk about national issues, they talk about the kind of Arab-Israeli conflict, they talk about US-Israeli relations, for many, Netanyahu's perhaps longest lasting legacy was the work he did in a very short time as Minister of the Finance. He resigned from the government, not on any economic issue, but he resigned from the government on Mr. Sharon's decision to withdraw from the Gaza Strip. That said, what he achieved in a short time, I think remains an extremely important thing to analyze as part of his legacy. So Netanyahu comes back to power in 2009, as I mentioned at the start. And we see a number of reasons for that. The incapacitation and eventual death of Ariel Sharon, the fragmentation of Likud into Kadima, and then the Likud, Netanyahu staying in the Likud, and eventually Netanyahu having to rebuild the Likud, essentially from being broke, from being a small party in the Knesset, and having to re-establish the party and eventually secure an electoral victory over Kadima in 2009. Although I should say, as I mentioned before, Kadima was the largest party in the Knesset, but only just, and Likud was able to put together a winning coalition. And then we come to look, I think, at the key issues of the second Netanyahu administration, which is much longer, as you know. And I look at Israeli, US-Israeli relations, part one, and then part two. Part one and part two. Obama and Netanyahu, clearly, Obama comes to power around about the same time as Netanyahu, taking office in January 2009. Clearly, two leaders with very different visions on outlooks on life, outlooks on politics. In terms of the Palestinians, clearly two leaders with very different visions. Two key speeches I think are important to stress. Obama's speech in Cairo, in which he talked about the needs of the Palestinians, about a two-state solution. And Benjamin Netanyahu's speech about 3 weeks later at Bar-Ilan near Tel Aviv, in which he said he accepted a Palestinian state, a two-state solution with certain conditions. And the whole sort of playing out between the two of the negotiations over the Palestinians, or trying to talk about negotiations, because they really didn't proceed to meaningful negotiations. And really looking at how the legacy between these two leaders plays out. And of course, the backdrop to all of this, and the two issues were related here, was the Iranian nuclear deal. And again, differences of opinion. Obama pushing for the deal with Iran, diplomatic deal. Netanyahu much more skeptical. And then, of course, the deal being agreed and the Americans signing the deal with Iran, much to the horror of Netanyahu. And this we see playing out in the second part of US-Israeli relations, which we see, as you know, President Trump winning the election and coming to power. And we see a much more aligned leadership between the two leaders. Palestinians largely excluded from the whole process, the Iran deal torn up. And then we see what I think is a shift, which many people I think have missed under the second Netanyahu administration, which is really, I think, a very important thing to consider and to think about the implications of this. The move really away from exclusivity of bilateral negotiations with the Arabs towards multilateral negotiations with the Arabs. This is something that Israeli leaders prior to Netanyahu had completely ruled out. Israel preferred to deal with the Arab countries one by one and deal with the Palestinians separately. Clearly, there had been seismic shifts in the last couple of years and shifts more towards a bilateral approach. And Netanyahu has made noises that when he was prime minister, that under certain conditions, he would tolerate bilateral negotiations as a means of moving forward. And I think that's something that is an important part of his legacy that is, like I say, has literally been missed by many. And you see another couple of points here, you know, the result of this greater alignment between the leaders, which was the two things that I think Israel most wanted from America, apart from arms sales in terms of the development of new Iron Dome technology. I think the two things that Israel wanted the most were the US embassy move from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem and the recognition of the Golan Heights, the annexation of the Golan Heights, which had taken place in 1981. And I think from that point of view, I think Netanyahu would point in terms of his legacy, if he were giving the talk instead of myself, he would mention those three points, I think. The Iran deal was ripped up, US embassy moved to Jerusalem, and recognition of Golan annexation. From his perspective, you may agree with those things as good or bad or not, but from his perspective, he would cite those as examples of his legacy. Israeli-Russian relations, again, very, very important, often away from the spotlight, much less media coverage on this. But clearly, Russian has significant aims in the Middle East to be a major player, and Israel has to deal with this and has to find ways of dealing with President Putin and developing ties with President Putin. And to a certain extent, Netanyahu has been moderately successful in this. The Syrian civil war, I think, has been a product of this, and particularly preventing the Syrian civil war from actually coming across into Israel or drawing Israel into the conflict, I think has been a meaningful achievement for any regime, whatever their political color in Israel. Less successful has been stopping arms sales by Moscow to the Arab states, specifically to Damascus. And looking at strategic cooperation in key areas has been problematic, but that's largely been because of American pressure not to cooperate strategically in certain key areas that we could talk more specifically if we had more time about, but that's something different. UK relations with Israel. The exit of Britain from Europe, I think, has been very important for Israel and Europe. For many years, Britain has been the policeman, if you like, for Israel in Europe. For all the rhetoric from British politicians, Britain has prevented the EU largely from adopting more anti-Israel measures, particularly trade measures, and really trying to stop, I think, the Europeans converting their financial investments in the region into more concerted political efforts in the region. And I think that, from an Israeli point of view, from Netanyahu's point of view, has been very significant. Anglo-Israeli relations, which have been very rocky for much of the history of the state of Israel, have been on a much more even keel. Netanyahu, particularly under the conservative governments of David Cameron, Theresa May, and now Boris Johnson, have been really much better than I think they have been for a long, long time. And I think, you know, Israeli European relations have always been very much tied to the Palestinian tract, which reflects the European view that peacemaking, that the Israeli-Palestinian conflict is at the core of the conflict, needs to be resolved first, contrary to the American view, which much more talks about interstate peace agreements with, you know, Israel-Egypt, Israel-Jordan, and potentially Israel-Syria eventually as well, and Israel-Lebanon, with the Palestinians sort of coming down later. I think there's a rocky road ahead coming in UK-European relations. That's something maybe from the questions that people might want to focus on. Just quickly going through, as we're running out of time, international achievements. Clearly, you know, the peace accords, the Abraham agreements, a sizable achievement for any leader. You know, normalization, the road to normalization with key Arab states, I think is again very important. Netanyahu, like him or loathe him, has really fought above Israel's weight internationally. I think Israel is a small country, very much on the international stage. He's played a much more vocal role, a little bit like Margaret Thatcher in Britain. It's a rough comparison, but a little bit like Margaret Thatcher really fought above Britain's weight internationally and domestically. I think you can say the same about Netanyahu. Deflection of international pressure from the United States, good thing or bad thing, but I'm sure if Netanyahu was giving this talk, he would say that's a good thing. And as I mentioned, the Iranian nuclear program, again, that remains to be seen if that was a short-term victory for Netanyahu or was actually something more meaningful in the longer term. Successor, well, you know, are we at the end of the line for Netanyahu, or is this just a pause? I cite Ben-Gurion's sabbatical in the 1950s. Is Netanyahu just on a forced sabbatical? Will he come back? The passing of the budget last week in Israel seems to indicate that it won't be happening in the next weeks or months, but we don't know. The government in Israel is very fragile. I think on socioeconomic issues and secular religious issues, it will probably survive. However, if Hamas start launching attacks from Gaza, or if Hezbollah start launching attacks from Lebanon, or both, then the fragile state of the government may be exposed by people breaking off from it, and, you know, it may lose a vote of confidence. But for that, it's very difficult to sort of crystal ball gaze. And so just finally, as a kind of conclusion, the Arab-Israeli conflict, I think we need to look at the three areas of legacy. Arab-Israeli conflict and overseas, foreign affairs. And this, I think, is, you know, we've covered in detail already. Secular religious issues. And here, I think it largely depends on your own beliefs on secular religious issues. Clearly, there has been a shift under Netanyahu in the power balance in terms of secular religious issues and in terms of coalition formation and the significance of the ultra-Orthodox and the Orthodox members of the Knesset. And that's something that has, I think, is from your own judgmental point of view, is whether or not you think that's a good thing or not. Socioeconomic issues. As I said, I think that many ways, perhaps his most lasting achievement to Israel will be the economic reforms that are still far from complete, by the way. He was much less successful as prime minister in terms of socioeconomic reforms than he was as minister of finance. And the Israeli economy still needs more economic reforms to make it more efficient and effective. So I think very much the jury is still out on that. And I would have to say that, you know, for many of the things we're talking about tonight, the jury is still really out on a lot of it, because this is a very short-term assessment. And hopefully, if you invite me back in a couple of years, I'll be able to give you a much longer term assessment. So I'll finish there and I'll be happy to take questions that you will have posed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Lockery. That was an excellent overview of Netanyahu's long career. And I want to, we have about 20 minutes for questions. So I want to encourage our audience members to send in questions. I'll be monitoring the Q&A box as those questions come in. I want to begin with a kind of general framing question about how we understand Netanyahu. There seems to be among biographers and among analysts and pundits, a kind of debate, ongoing debate, as to whether he's best understood as a pragmatist, as you've suggested, somebody, you know, really just without necessarily a clear set of ideological maxims or principles, or whether he is fundamentally at heart an ideologue. You know, the latter view points to the influence of somebody, and I know you didn't discuss this, but I'd like you to comment on this, on his father's influence, Benzion Netanyahu. Whether ultimately, you know, behind the kind of pragmatism and flexibility, there was underlying that a real ideological project. And so I want to know whether you think that's true, whether you think at the core of Netanyahu is a set of ideological views, maybe particularly in terms of the Arab-Israeli conflict, or whether this was really a man whose only ideology was staying in power.
Okay, thank you. That's a very good question. Let me answer it this way. First of all, by saying someone's a pragmatist, I don't think you're necessarily saying that someone doesn't have any kind of political compass. I think you can be a pragmatist and still shift within a range of policies which you are willing to embrace or not. I don't think I agree with the idea that if someone's a pragmatist, that they're only in power for power's sake. I think that is something that I don't think would have appealed to him. I don't think he's an ideologue in the way his father was. His father was very much a product of the times. You know, his father was, you know, the secretary to Jabotinsky. He was a man who actually many people in the revisionist Zionist movement were uncomfortable with, including Menachem Begin. He was an outsider within the revisionist movement. And his father clearly was a very strong ideologue. Now, how much of that, I think the question was, rubbed off on Netanyahu, and how much of his sort of pragmatism is a kind of front, a kind of con act, is the question, I think. And I think Netanyahu has a clearly defined set of ideas as to where he wants to go. And yes, those ideas are steeped in Jewish history. And you can't ignore his connection to Jewish history. You would be insane to completely say he's just living in the present tense or the future. This is a man who studies passionately Jewish history. This is a man who reads, you know, widely books on Jewish history, who likes to lecture. You know, he lectured Barack Obama in the White House about Jewish history. So yes, of course, the influence of his father, the influence of Jewish history are there. But I think he's realistic enough to know that he can't get everything he wants, that pressure-wise, the international environment he moves in, particularly with the Americans, limits his room for maneuver. But he is, in my opinion, a pragmatist, but he does have a clear set of goals as to what he wants and ways in which he wants to do things. And I think we saw a lot more of that during the Trump administration and the state of US-Israeli relations during that. I think we saw much more of that then than we did during the Obama administration. And what he clearly wants is a very strong, stable Israeli state with secure boundaries. And he wants Israel to be economically, militarily, and politically a major player in the Middle East region and beyond. And his pragmatism is shown by the fact he's willing to deal with whoever within the state system of the Arab world and beyond is willing to deal with him.
So you don't think that Netanyahu wanted to retain indefinitely Judea and Samaria, the West Bank indefinitely? Was what has preventing the establishment of a Palestinian state been one of his overriding kind of ideological political objectives, or not central to his mission?
Well, as you know, the ideological cornerstone of Likud has always been a greater Israel, you know, incorporating Judea and Samaria. Menachem Begin reiterated time and time again, even when he was losing elections in Israel for 29 years. And so it has been an important part. I think Likud and Netanyahu have moved away to a more modern approach towards that. Yes, they would like as much land as possible. But, and it's a big but, I think there's more of a realistic acceptance that while this might remain an ideological dream, an ideological goal, in practical terms, it's not really possible. This is just my own opinion.
So that he's been willing to kind of accept some form of Palestinian statehood, or a state minus, as he likes to call it.
Yeah.
So we have a question from Robert Turner on that, actually, who asks whether Netanyahu sees a Palestinian state in the West Bank as the only possible form of a two-state solution, or given the fact that he's insisted upon extending Israeli sovereignty to the Jordan Valley and increasing the presence of Israeli Jewish settlers in the West Bank, did he have in mind another potential location for a Palestinian state? You know, Shawan famously and Begin talked about Jordan being the location, perhaps the Gaza Strip and some territory around that. Has he thought in those terms?
Well, in many ways, every Israeli leader's dream was to resolve the Palestinian issue through Jordan. I mean, the Jordanian option was the favored way until King Hussein relinquished Jordanian claims to the West Bank in 1987 as a result of the failed London agreement between himself and Shimon Peres. And that, up until the present day, has really removed the Jordanian option unless the Hashemite kingdom falls. But at present, that's not a realistic option. In terms of Gaza, well, there has been much talk about expanding the borders out of Gaza, with Egypt giving some land, Israel giving land, and creating, you know, a much bigger sort of enclave out of Gaza. In terms of a Palestinian state, that for me really is a long way down the road. At the moment, with the problems we have to deal with, are effectively in negotiations, you have to negotiate with two different leaderships altogether, the Palestinian Authority in the West Bank and the Hamas in Gaza. And until there is a single sole Palestinian leadership within those two territories, it makes any negotiations about a Palestinian state in those two areas not redundant, but incredibly complicated to achieve. What happens if one accepts and the other rejects? Therefore, you know, these are things I very much hope negotiations will start in the foreseeable future. But I think for a precursor for viable negotiations to start, we need to see Palestinian elections and the election of a sole Palestinian body. I mean, we haven't had a Palestinian election since 2006, I believe.
Certainly. I guess what I'm asking, you know, in a roundabout way is when we think about Begin, Begin was clear about his desired end goal, the ultimate Israeli sovereignty over the entire area. And other Israeli leaders have been equally clear about their end goal. Prime Minister Bennett is pretty clear about what he would like, which is Israeli sovereignty over Area C and maybe a small Palestinian state. With Netanyahu, we're still wondering. I mean, this is a man who was in power for 12 years and totally in 15 years, and we still don't really have a clear sense of what end goal he envisaged. What was his ideal, maybe not possible, but his ideal scenario for how Israel and the Palestinians would coexist?
Okay, it's a good point. The first thing I'd like to say is that Menachem Begin was a very interesting case. When you look at his autonomy plan from 1977, December 77, I believe, that autonomy plan went a lot further than anyone possibly dreamt of it going. And yes, he wanted to gain sovereignty over Judea and Samaria, but that gave an enormous amount of autonomy to the Palestinians. So I'm not sure the case of Begin is quite as black and white. When he was in opposition, yes, he talked about first thing he would do when he came to power, I will annex Judea and Samaria on the first day that I arrive in the prime minister's office. He didn't. And I think his case is less black and white than perhaps we think. In terms of Netanyahu, let me try and explain what I think happened. I think Netanyahu shifted from being never really wishing to declare his true hand, because he shifted between the needs of his constituents and specifically his governing coalition and his cabinet and international pressure, specifically not from the Europeans, but from the Americans, who were pushing hard. And I think he was very nervous about declaring any kind of position because he believed it was a no-win situation for him. If I declare a position now, I lose with my cabinet and my constituency, and look at the trouble he had getting the Hebron Accords through in 1997, his cabinet. And there, or he has to annoy the Americans, and there are major implications. I mean, Obama was really getting quite hostile towards him, so he needed to be very careful. So I think he thinks it as a game of poker. Final status talks are still to come. Why should I give away so much? Why should I give away how I envisage in the end game? Because that's going to have implications for the negotiations. I think it's good politics.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, he certainly is a master tactician, that's for sure. So I want to turn to the domestic, and you talked at the beginning about his impact on Israeli political culture. And indeed, you know, the kind of Americanization or modernization of Israeli politics that's really associated with Netanyahu more than any other modern Israeli politician. In recent years, he was criticized heavily inside and outside Israel for undermining some of the features of democracy in Israel, for challenging Israel's judiciary, the rule of law, for trying to interfere in how the media covered him. And of course, that was one of the corruption charges against him that he's now on trial for. Could you say a little bit about his attitude toward democracy in Israel? In recent years, particularly while Trump was in office, he was sometimes put in the camp along with Trump, Viktor Orban in Hungary, or Recep Tayyip Erdogan in Turkey, and Bolsonaro, you know, these kind of authoritarian populists who ran roughshod over the democratic process and really couldn't really care less as long as they stayed in power. Do you think that kind of comparison is a fair one? How do you see his impact upon the fabric of Israeli democracy?
Okay, I mean, all the points you make are completely fair, and I'm not here to defend Benjamin Netanyahu. I think the points you make are the attacks on the judiciary, the attacks on the media are unacceptable. But if I can just give some context to them, maybe. For all his time, we're talking about an Israeli prime minister who's the longest serving Israeli prime minister in the history of the state of Israel. And yet he still regards himself as an outsider in Israel. And he still regards key segments of Israel as being dominated by the left, by the founding fathers, the labor Zionism and their descendants. And the kind of elite in Israel is still very much less so now, but still, it's still dominated by center-left elements. And perhaps the two biggest examples you've just highlighted, one, the judiciary. And this is not a political judgment, but clearly that's what it is. And secondly, the Israeli media. the Israeli media is a lot more fragmented now than it used to be, but it still has strong, strong elements, I think. And he regards himself as an outsider, and he talks like an outsider as well, sometimes when he speaks. And that can be quite dangerous because he believes he is up against all these elites. When he was Minister of Finance, and I mentioned this in the talk, you know, he believed that all the cartels in Israel, from, you know, drinks companies to whatever else, were all out to get him, you know, and he was going to go and smash them. He was the outsider throwing stones from the outside. So that really hasn't changed. And it's quite a fascinating concept. You have this idea of a guy who's internationally widely seen as the face of Israel still. And yet, I think deep down, he still regards himself as something of an outsider within the elites of Israel. And I'm not justifying his attacks on the judiciary because they're not acceptable, nor am I justifying his attacks on the press or whatever. But that's, I think, the context of them.
Absolutely. So we have a couple of questions from Gary Gilbert and Haya Yachman, who are both asking about the corruption issue, which is obviously was the you know, one of the reasons why he was forced from office, and one of the reasons why there was four elections over the last 2 years, and he's still on trial. Could you say something about these corruption charges, or do you think they, and how do they compare? I mean, you compared him with those previous leaders. Is Netanyahu, in your estimation, particularly corrupt, or is this just another more attempt to kind of bring him down as he saw it?
Well, it's a really difficult question to answer briefly. I mean, the charges against him are complicated, and I wouldn't like to make any comments that are going to be, you know, he's going to have his day in court, obviously, and he'll be able to defend himself. I would go a little deeper and say, I'm afraid to say, I think systematically the Israeli political culture is rather corrupt. And I'm afraid it's not just Mr. Netanyahu. He may be the figurehead of it, but and it's not, nor is it just simply Ehud Olmert from 2008 to 2009, who, as you know, served a prison sentence. I think that there are enormous troubles in Israel. Israel is a very young democracy. Please remember that. Yeah, it was only founded in 1948. I've just spent, before I came on, reading newspaper accounts here in Great Britain. We are a very long, old, distinguished democracy, and we have terrible corruption that we are currently dealing with. It's something which is not unique to Israel. But I think in many ways, Israel had hoped, the founders and founding fathers and mothers of Israel had hoped that this wouldn't come to Israel, but it most certainly has. And I should also say, it's not just simply on the center left or center right. I think it's right across the board. And I would say it's also secular religious as well. And, you know, it's an extremely worrying, I worry enormously about Israeli democracy, actually much more than I worry about the Arab-Israeli conflict at the moment.
Okay, well, I'm going to put a couple more questions that have come in from our audience. So one was a question about the different ethnic groups in Israel and their support for Netanyahu. You alluded to the fact that much of Netanyahu's base of support on Mizrahi Jews. So he himself is Ashkenazi, but he's had, you know, generally in the base of the Likud party is Mizrahi Jews. What explains this, you know, his popularity, their enduring popularity? I mean, King Bibi, there's a kind of a third of the Israeli electorate who, despite the corruption charges and despite all of the, you know, accusations made about against him, have stuck by him. They're still standing by him to this day. Many of them are Mizrahi Jews. And yet he is somebody who is, in many ways, even though he sees himself as an outsider, is a quintessential insider. I mean, he's, come from a kind of very esteemed revisionist family. How do you explain that relationship and his ability to captivate that audience for so long?
Well, I would historically go back to Menachem Begin again and say it was Menachem Begin who developed the ties between Likud and the Orientals, the Sephardim. And Begin, as you said, was himself Ashkenazi. I mean, but he spoke spoke the kind of language which they liked. And the electoral victory in 77 was largely based on, or partly based on, the support of Sephardim. Certainly the electoral victory in 81 was strongly based on the support of the Sephardim. Turns to Mr. Netanyahu, well, I think you need to go a little deeper here and say, I think it's about ownership of Israel here. I think there are different groups who want to own Israel. I think Netanyahu positions himself very cleverly as an outsider, but anyone can do that. But he's effectively saying the elites are ganging up on me and you together. And we are the outsiders, and they want to control Israel. They being maybe the elites that we previously mentioned, center left elites or whatever, and they don't want you to earn a fair salary, etc. So he does appeal very cleverly, but there is something much deeper about it. And I think it's, this question of who does Israel belong to, I think really goes to the heart of this. And he articulates it very cleverly in election. And they'll just view the corruption charges against him as essentially, fake charges put up to get rid of him. I can see you're coughing. Are you okay?
Yes, I'm fine. Sorry. I'm going to ask one last question, and it's come from a couple of members of the audience, Neil Kogut and Martin Klempner, who are both asking about Netanyahu's relation in the context of his relations with the United States, his outreach with evangelical Christians, and he's really building up that relationship.
Yeah.
And the perception among many American Jews, particularly liberal American Jews, that he really disregarded that relation, their relationship with them, that he couldn't really care less about American Jewish sensibilities, and he focused really much more on evangelical Christians. Do you accept that critique, or do you think, yes?
Yes, I do. I wouldn't go as far as say that he doesn't care about the American Jews, but he would probably argue that he views them as center left. Many of them as center left. He's looking at building coalitions of support for himself. Evangelicals were a perfect match for him, but particularly with the election of Donald Trump, this really manifests itself. So yes, I think that's an absolute fair comment, and the question following that would be, what's the medium to long term damage going to be in U.S. Israeli relations, specifically relations between Israel and American Jewry? I mean, how is that going to pan out? Are they simply going to be repaired with the removal of Netanyahu, or is this a sign of actually something deeper and more profoundly worrying?
You put that very well, and unfortunately we are out of time, so we cannot take up that question now. But I want to thank you so much for sharing your insights about Netanyahu, about his life, his contribution to Israeli politics. I want to thank all of our audience for all of the questions. There are many more questions than we had time for. But we will be putting this on this recording on our website as well as on our YouTube channel. So hopefully you will share that widely. And I want to thank Professor Lockery for joining us, and finally encourage you all to attend our next big event, which will be on Sunday, November the 21st, a conference we've organized with Haaretz newspaper. We'll be hearing from Benny Gantz, Zippy Livni, many other Israeli politicians, policymakers, and experts looking at Israeli national security. And one of the issues we'll be discussing is the question that Professor Lockery just put in the what damage long-term has been done to the US-Israel relationship, and whether the US-Israel relationship can be, or the bipartisan support for US-Israel relationship can be restored. So hopefully you'll join us all on Sunday, November the 21st. Thank you and goodbye.